This is a Markan, quote, sandwich, unquote, story, in which one story is embedded in another. And in each instance of this story structure, the purpose is to make the stories comment on each other. So we want to, you know, pay attention to the way in which the story of Jesus' family coming to get him and the redefinition of his family that he does and the controversy with the scribes who'd come down from Jerusalem who were saying that he had Beelzebul, how those are connected and how they comment on each other. The classic instance of this structure in Mark is the embedding of the story of the woman who touched Jesus' garment in the story of the raising of Jairus' daughter in 521 to 43. And other instances are the fig tree and the cleansing of the temple in chapter 11, the anointing at Bethany and the plot of the priests, 14:1 to 11, the trial before the Sanhedrin that is embedded in the story of Peter's denial, 14:53 to 72. This interweaving of stories is one of Mark's characteristic, you know, styles of storytelling. Now, in these two stories, the controversy with the religious authorities over their accusation that the spirit-empowering Jesus' exorcisms is Beelzebul is embedded in the story of Jesus' family. Both groups share a common conclusion. His mother and his brothers think that he's lost his mind, and the authorities think an evil spirit has possessed him. And so this controversy over the character of the spirit that is inspiring Jesus is at the core of the issue. In the telling of this story, this is the longest extended speech in which the storyteller, as Jesus, addresses the audience as a character in the story. And I just want to make a couple comments about this dynamic of audience address. In the telling of a story, the storyteller becomes the character who is speaking, and especially when there's a long speech. Well, the only long speeches in the Gospels are, well, the major ones, almost all, are speeches of Jesus. And when Jesus speaks, that is when the storyteller speaks Jesus' words and embodies Jesus and makes Jesus present, the audience is invited to become, that is to occupy the character of the character whom Jesus is speaking to. So when there's a long address, for example, to the disciples in chapter 13, the audience is invited to hear this as the disciples, that is, to identify with the disciples and to, in effect, join the disciples listening to Jesus talking to them on the Mount of Olives overlooking the temple. And this happens with many of the long speeches that Jesus has in the course of the gospel. So you can identify who the audience is invited to become by paying attention to the dynamic of the story. Well, in this instance, the audience is addressed as the scribes who had come down from Jerusalem, that is, who had come down from the mountains of Jerusalem and had moved north up into Galilee. The shorter instances of audience address are John the Baptist addressing the crowd in the wilderness, Jesus addressing the audience as the scribes in the healing of the paralytic, the people asking Jesus about why his disciples don't fast, and the Pharisees with two controversies with Jesus about working on the Sabbath, the one of the disciples harvesting grain by rubbing it in their hands, and the other the man with the withered hand. This story is then the climax of a series of conflict stories in which the storyteller as Jesus addresses the audience as various Jewish groups who are engaged in controversies with him. So this is both the most intense, polarized conflict story, and then it ends with the most intimate and inclusive invitation for the audience to identify themselves as members of Jesus' family. And so it's the most intimate conversation between Jesus, presented by the storyteller, and the audience. So the dynamics of audience address here are, on the one hand, highly polarized, that is, the audience is invited to make a decision. about whether or not the Spirit in Jesus is the spirit of the devil or whether it is the Holy Spirit, and then to identify themselves as members of Jesus' family. So the story heightens the issue and requires the audience to decide about the controversies that he has generated over Sabbath law, over fasting, over his authority to forgive sins, over eating with unclean persons, over accepting a tax collector as a disciple. And one of the things that you can notice with all of these is that the audience is invited to identify with issues that are highly specific to the Jewish community of the first century. So Sabbath law was only an issue for Jews. Eating with unclean persons was a distinctively Jewish issue, as fasting and the authority to forgive sins are also. So probability is then that Mark was speaking to an audience that was predominantly Jewish in its identity, and that there may have been Gentiles who were Jewish in their identity, that is, who had identified with the traditions of Israel, who also may have listened to this story. Now, the specifics of this. The charge of the scribes who had come down from Jerusalem are the most serious accusation as yet in the story. The earlier charges were blasphemy for pronouncing the forgiveness of sins by some scribes, questions about his eating with sinners, not fasting, and the most serious conflict stories prior to this have been over working on the Sabbath. Character of their accusation is that Jesus is an ally of Satan, that he is a demonic figure who is operating by the power of the spirit of Satan. And Jesus' response is also the most intense to this point in the story. The charge of an unforgivable sin is a very serious charge. So this is a highly intense conflict, the culmination of all the conflicts that have preceded it. High volume, polarized conflict. It'd be hard for you in telling this to overdo the degree of conflict that's present. Now, the character of the argument. There are two themes. First, Jesus' response to their accusation is that it isn't possible for an ally of Satan to be attacking Satan. It's just an internal contradiction. If there is such intense spiritual division in the house of Satan, then the house is divided and it cannot stand. Well, Satan's power is clearly not gone. Therefore, this is not an act of Satan. And the same is present in the parable of the strong man, the same implication. You can't raid and run plunder a strong man's stuff unless you first bind the strong man. Satan's stuff is being plundered. The power of Satan, expressed in sickness, in division, in leprosy, in paralysis, is being healed, transformed. The only way in which that's possible is if Satan is being bound. That is, this isn't being done by an ally of Satan. It's only being done by somebody who is an opponent of Satan and is binding him and doing what Satan would not want. The other theme is that this pronouncement of calling these actions, actions of Satan, is blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. It is calling the Holy Spirit, which is the only spirit that could be doing this, the spirit of Satan. That constitutes blasphemy. And his pronouncement is a very serious pronouncement. I remember a student who had a person who had come to him and said, you know, I can never be forgiven. I've been condemned to hell. I've been condemned by God forever because I cursed God. And so I explained to the student, you know, what the character of blasphemy was, and that that cursing did not constitute blasphemy necessarily. And so he went home and told this guy, it actually changed his life because he had thought he was under an eternal sentence. So it's important to understand the specifics of this and to make the connections appropriately. Well, the story then goes back to the family and the issues of the family. Now, the theme of Jesus' family is pursued in Mark, and this is the first introduction of his family. And in this instance, his mother and his brothers think that he's crazy and have come to seize him, take him home, because he's gone out of his mind. Later, when Jesus speaks and teaches in his home synagogue in Nazareth, people are offended at him then. That's in chapter 6. And they do not accept him. So Jesus has had this problem with the people who he grew up with. Later, at the cross and at the tomb, the implication of the story is that his mother is present and that she had been with him and had served him and that there had been some reconciliation. But it's very indirect. So here, there is this conflict between Jesus and his family. And when they call for him and want to talk to him, the implication is that they're going to grab him and take him home. So Jesus does not go out to meet them. Instead, in response to the statement of those who are sitting around him, your mother and your brothers are outside, Jesus just stays there and doesn't go out and talk to his mother and his brothers, which is a significant sign of, what shall we call it? Family alienation. The dynamic of the story is, once again, a dynamic of audience address. And in this instance, Jesus is addressing the audience, that is, the storyteller's audience. The storyteller is Jesus addressing his audience as those who are sitting around him. In fact, this scene, as it is described, may reflect the primary context in which Mark's gospel was told. That is, of a storyteller with people sitting around him. And that when Jesus then, when the storyteller then says, "Here are my mother and my brothers," he's gesturing to those who are sitting around him, who are addressed then as Jesus' mother and brothers. The invitation of the story is to become a part of Jesus' family, to be a Jesus groupie. And it redefines the character of a family, not as biological identity, descent, but as spiritual identity. And that Jesus then invites everyone who listens to his story to become part of his family. So the overall dynamic of both the telling of this story and its interpretation is to establish this close, intimate, familial relationship with Jesus. That's the invitation of the story and its primary impact. Now, how then are the two stories related? The story of Beelzebul and of Jesus' family is the climax of this whole section of the introduction of the gospel of the first three chapters. And it is a point of decision for the listeners. What is Jesus' spirit? Is it a demonic spirit or is it a Holy Spirit? Is he right about these issues about which there has been controversy? And who is your family? Is your primary identity tied up with your biological family or with your spiritual family? So the invitation of this story is then to invest in your spiritual family and to become part of this unique love relationship with Jesus. So have fun telling the story.